Temperature is dropping, and then we will place it back into the warm water, and we will see again a nice transient response. So let's just stop the measurement. So what you see here is the transient response from air to water. See, it's evolving in time. Here we had steady state. This was the air temperature. This was the water temperature. This was the transition between the hot water and cold water. Again, transient response. And here we have a similar response from cold water to hot water again. So what can we see here? We can see that it takes some time before the sensor can react, and that the shape of the function is pretty similar in this area, in this area, in this area. It means that we can describe this whole transient response as one function, and it will be a differential function, and its solution will be this time function. So we have seen something like this. The sensor is reacting to the change on sensor input. So sensor input, let's say that it was a step change. So this was the cold temperature, this was the hot water, and here we had such a transient response. The steady state was somewhere around here, and therefore it's going near the steady state value. So in other words, the dynamic error is zero. I will come back shortly to this chart, just put in something more. So how can we describe the function? How can we describe the step response? In general case, any system can be described by a differential equation. It can be an nth order differential equation. So here we have the general formula. We have some coefficients a, an, a2, a1, a0 eventually. This is the output of the sensor, and derivative, second derivative, first derivative, and so on. So in general case, it can be an arbitrary order. And on the right-hand side of the equation, we have the input function x. It may have some coefficient. It may be called, for example, b here, b0. That's the most typical value that you just have one coefficient there. So this is a general description. But as we are trying to simplify our solutions, we are generally trying to use just first order or second order differential equations. Because the simplification with first or second order is sufficient to describe almost all systems. Sometimes you can see third order differential equations, but not that often. And we will work only with first order system, the first order description, and we will just briefly talk about the second order, just to see what are the effects of the high order there. So, if we have just a first order differential equation, then it means we have just this part, a1, y prime, plus a0, y equals x, eventually x with some coefficient. So, the first order system is described with a first order differential equation, which has this form. Here you already see the b0. And one of the most important things that we will learn here is that the ratio between a1 and a0, so you know, if we divide the whole equation with a0, so then this a1 over a0 will be called the time constant. And the time constant is the single parameter that describing the behavior of the system in time. It is very important for all dynamic systems because the time constant is saying you how fast the system is. If the time constant is short, then it means that the sensor or any system can react quite quickly. If the system has a large time constant, then you will have a slow response of the system. So you need to be able to work with this differential equation and get the time constant from the coefficients. So the time constant is telling us how fast the system is. So if you see the differential equation in this form, and this is the time constant. And here on the right side, B0 over A0, we have seen this already. It's nothing else than the sensitivity. We've been talking about this last week. And the sensitivity is saying us how is the system reacting in steady state. So if I am in steady state, what is the value of the first derivative of y? Zero. Zero, obviously. Because in steady state, nothing is changing. So this is zero. And we have y equals b0 over a0 times x. So in steady state, this is the steady state equation. And this was added to describe the dynamic behavior. So steady state is described by this. This ratio, B0 over A0, we call it of sensitivity. Sometimes you see it's also called steady state gain. And it's describing the behavior in steady state. But not only in steady state, but mostly in steady state. So my colleague made me aware that the camera is already working, so just put on the microphone, perhaps some records that I can give you on the internet. It will not be with the beginning, unfortunately, because he had some trouble, but at least something for the people who can't come to the lecture. Okay, so what can we see from this differential equation? It's a differential equation, and if we want to plot it as a function of time, we need to find the solution of this differential equation. So from mathematics, the solution of such a first order differential equation is nothing else than an exponential function. And it has this form. Here we have the output, so that's the function that we are looking for, the development in time. Here we have the value of the steady state output, so y infinity. And here we have 1 minus e to the power of minus t over tau. And tau is the time constant. And if you look on this equation, you see that the only parameter that is saying you how fast the system is nothing else than this time constant tau here. So if tau is small, if the system is quite fast, then it will react very quickly and will go easily to the new steady state. If for some reason the time constant is large, then the system will be slow and it will take a long time before you go to the steady state. As time is increasing here, you have t, this is time, then with increasing t, this part of the equation is getting smaller and smaller, and the system is going near to the steady state value. So if I go back to the
chart over here, we see that this is the development of the output. And since it's a simple exponential function, we can use the time constant to say how fast it is. If you would calculate the values of output of y, so let's say this, we have y as a function of time is y infinity 1 minus e t over tau. So if you would calculate this equation, then you would find out that for some specific values of time with regards to the time constant, you can get the ratio between the steady state and between the actual value of the output. In other words, here if you substitute tau into this equation, so the time is equal exactly to the time constant, then the result will be 63.2% of the steady state value. So here you see I have my steady state value, and when I have reached one time constant, I have reached exactly 63%, 63.2%. Probably just let me do this. Here you see that the x scale is t over tau. So it's not time, but it's the ratio between the time and time constant. So when I'm at the instant one, then I'm exactly at 63.2%. And we'll use this also in our lab experiments to get the value of the time constant with an experiment. If you substitute three time constants here into this equation, then you will see that you are going roughly to 95% of the new steady state value. And if you substitute five time constants, then you are going just a little bit higher than 99% of the new steady state value. So how can we use this to get a time time constant? Let's say I have some measured data. Let's say it's this, what we have just measured a few minutes ago. So here we have some record over there, and now the question is, what is the time constant? So let me just zoom it a little bit. So this is a nice transient response. Let's say it's a first order transient response. So what would be the time constant? Well, I can say that I'm looking for the time at which I have reached 63% of the steady state value. So I need the step size. Step size from this steady state to this steady state. So let's say, so let's put some markers here. So here for this steady state I have this value, so here 87 microvolts, well let's say 88 microvolts, and for this new steady state, let's say it's somewhere here, I have 668 microvolts. So this is the step size in here, and this is 100%. I'm looking for the value at which it will reach 63%. So 50% somewhere around here, 63% will be somewhere around here. We can do it exactly, but I'll not do it on the lecture. So let's say this is time zero, and somewhere, not here, but somewhere around here, we have 63%. So this is the value of time constant. let me just plot it as a chart. Here, if I have time, this is sensor output and sensor input. So if sensor input is this, so this is X, that's the step I have made on the input. The transient response is something like this, say an exponential function. Well, not that sharp, but something like that. Then this is 100%. And I'm looking for the value of 63, which is somewhere here. 63.2%, and this will be the time constant. So like this you can get quite easily the time constant from measured data, and then you can use this in some differential equation to describe your system mathematically. There is another way how this could be done. It is a property of the exponential function that if you make a tangent at any point, so let's say I'll make a tangent at the origin like this, so this is a tangent at the origin, then the time it takes to reach the steady state by the tangent is also the time constant. So this is the same value like you have here. And I said that it works at any point. So if, for example, I make a tangent at this point, then the time from here to here is again the time constant. So if for some reason you can't tell when did this step change start, then you can make a tangent at an arbitrary point and then just get the time constant in this way. So we'll use this quite often in the labs. We have several experiments where you will get this kind of measured data, and your goal will be to get the time constant. Obviously, the time constant will be a property of the system. So if you have a different sensor, it will have a different time constant. It will depend also on the way you install the sensor. If you need some mechanical protection, then it will increase the time constant. So, as we have been talking last week about steady state, I've told you that in reality this equation that is describing a behavior in time, the new steady state is reached when the time is infinite. Because only when t is going to infinity, this part of the equation is going to zero. But as you see here, luckily the new steady state is reached quite fast, because if I am within 5 time constants, then I'm within 99% of the new steady state. So if I know the time constant of my system or of my sensor, then I just multiply this number by 5, and I know how long do I need to wait to be in the new steady state. An example, again, this chart. Let's say the time constant of my sensor is 1 minute. Then if I wait 1 minute only, then I'm within 63.2% of the new steady state. That's typically not sufficient. If I wait 3 minutes, then I'm within 95% of the new steady state. But if I wait 5 minutes, then I'm within 99%. So for this particular sensor with time constant of 1 minute, I need to wait at least 5 minutes before I can read the output of the sensor. And I can be sure that this is the correct value. If I read it sooner, then I will have some smaller value on the output, and my reading will not be correct. Once again, let me repeat that. That's one of the fundamentals here in this class, that one time constant is 63%, roughly. Three time constant is 95%, and five time constant is 99%. Any questions so far? Okay, so this was the first order system. We will assume that all systems that we will use in the lab are first order systems. In reality, this is not true. In reality, all the systems are some higher order systems. We're just trying to make the equations look simple. In some cases, you cannot use the simple first order differential equation, the first order system, and we will need to know some higher order systems. I will just talk very briefly about the second order system. We'll not go into the mathematical solutions. The second order system obviously is described by a second order differential equation. So you can see it here, A2, Y second derivative, and so on. On the right side of the equation, you can again have B0 plus X, eventually B1 plus X prime, and so on. But this is the most simple form. In this case, the solution of the second order differential equation depends on the coefficients. So it depends on the coefficients A2, A1, and A0. And based on those coefficients, you will have different possibilities because you will have different roots of the differential equation. The equation roots, I'll call them lambda 1 and lambda 2. If the roots are complex numbers, then you will have an oscillatory response. If the roots are real numbers, the response will not be oscillatory. You probably know this from mathematics, so we'll not need it anyway in the mathematical form. What we will need is this chart. So if the roots of the differential equations are complex numbers, you have an oscillatory response. So it typically looks like this. You have a steady state value, so this is the step that you make on the input. And you have some overshoot on the output, and then you have some oscillations, and it gets near the new steady state value. For some systems, this is not a problem. For example, if you control temperature, and eventually you have this kind of oscillations, then it's not a problem at all. Because this band of oscillations can be made very small, and if you control, for example, the temperature in a room, then it doesn't really matter if it fluctuates plus minus 1 degree. But if this would be, for example, position control for a mill, then you imagine I machine some product, and this is the position. Let's say I want to manufacture some diameter. Then if I have some overshoot in here, then it means I will remove some material and I cannot put it back. So for some systems, this is okay. For some systems, it's not. If the roots of the differential equation of your system are real numbers, so lambda 1 equals to lambda 2, and it's real, then you have this kind of response that we called aperiodic function. You see that there is no oscillations at all, and the system is as fast as it can be without the oscillations. So it goes right to the steady state value, not without any oscillations. If I need some faster response, I will have definitely some oscillations, and in some cases it's okay, in some cases it's not. The third option is when lambda 1 and lambda 2 are not equal and they are real numbers, and then you have real different roots, it's still a response without oscillations, but it's definitely the slowest one. So sometimes you can tune the settings of your system to get the response that you want. Well, now, how do you recognize at first glance if your system is a first order or a second order? You recognize that by looking on the beginning. You make the step change, and for a first order system it would look like this. It would react immediately and you would see some reaction. So this is a first order system. You see the tangent at the origin has some non-zero slope. But here, for the second order and any higher order systems, if you make the tangent at the beginning, then it has a zero slope. So it's looking like this. And then there is a slower transition and it will react. So if I look on my chart here, so if you look on this, then this looks like a first order system, but here the reason why it looks like a first order system is simply because I have set a relatively slow sample rate. So here it measured this temperature and here it measured the second temperature here. So those are the samples. If now I will change the sampling frequency and make it faster, then we will see that there will be a nice transition. So it's definitely not a first order system. Let's try that. Hold on. So let's do it again, and we'll see that it will look in a different way. Let's put it back into the hot water. So what do you see here? This was the transition from hot to cold. Definitely not a first order system. Here there is a non-zero, there is a zero slope at this point when it started. Then I have a transient response. I'm specifically not talking about this, because here I made a change between cold and hot. What do you think this notch is? Yes, exactly. So this is the air temperature. So this sensor is quite fast and it can react very quickly. So in other words, it has a small time constant. We will see also on the labs slower sensors with time constant, let's say 2 minutes, and they will definitely not do this. But they will act as higher order systems. You will have a non-zero, slow transition on the beginning. So one of my favorite questions in the test is also that you are asked to plot the difference between the first order and second order systems in this kind of chart. Any questions? Okay, good. So now we'll be talking about electrical circuits. If you have a sensor then this sensor is changing the physical property, temperature, humidity, pressure, into some useful electrical signal. Steady state characteristic or by a transient response or by both. The output needs to be some signal that we can process. So imagine we have some sensor that is measuring something. In my case, it was temperature. And the output will be some electrical signal. And I want to connect this electrical signal to a controller system that can be from a completely different manufacturer. So we will need some standards that will define us how to transfer the information from the sensor into the controller system. So we will need some standard signals, either voltage or currents. So the transducer itself needs to have some electronic circuits embedded and will take the small voltage or resistance or capacity from the sensor and will create another electric signal on the output that will be following some standards. So this unified output signal will be then connected to an arbitrary control system. And in this control system, we can say if voltage is 5 volt, it means that the temperature is 50 centigrades, for example. So in the control system, we will have some equation saying how is the voltage or current related to what we measure. Here in this table, you have just a selection of some standard signals that you may find in the industry. So you can use either voltage or current. Both have advantages and disadvantages. The ones that you have marked here in red color are the most common ones. So for voltage, it's 0 to 10 volts or minus 10 volts to plus 10 volts. Or 0 to 5 volts or minus 5 volts to 5 volts. But the most common signal in industrial systems is this 0 to 10 volts. The current signals used in industrial systems are typically 0 to 20 milliamperes, or the most common one is from 4 to 12 to 20 milliamperes. So here the information about the value that we measure is transferred as a voltage. Here the information is transferred as a current. And then in the system that is acquiring this voltage or current, we can say, okay, if it's 4 milliamperes, then temperature is 0 centigrades. If it's 20 milliamperes, then temperature is 100 centigrades. For example, it depends on the sensor and depends on the range that you want to measure. So, voltage and current signals. Where do we use them? And what are the advantages and disadvantages? The voltage signal is quite easy to produce. It's also very easy to transfer, but voltage signals are quite sensitive to noise. How does it work? Let's say here I have the sensor, and this is my measuring instrument, either a simple instrument or it could be a control system. So I transfer the voltage. On sensor output, I have V1. This is the wire, and the wire has some resistance, represented by this resistor here. And the voltage that I actually measure on the gauge, it's not the same as on the sensor output. Well, simply because I have some voltage drop on the wire resistance, so then V1 is not equal to V2. So I measure a different value that is available on the sensor output. But what's more important is that this voltage V2 will also change with eventual changes of the wire resistance. So if I make the wire longer, it will have a higher resistance if I keep the diameter, and therefore I will have a smaller value of V2. It can also change with temperature. The wiring in industrial systems can be very long. You can have sensors installed somewhere on the manufacturing or assembly line, and then you can have 100 meter of wire going to the control system. So if somewhere the temperature is changing, then here you have a change in the wire resistance, and therefore you will have a change in the voltage that you measure. Without the changes of V1. So V1 can be constant, but just if the temperature will change around the connecting wires, then you will have changes of V2. They can be very small, but then it depends on the accuracy that you want to achieve. So voltage signals are used in applications where this typically is not a problem, where you do not require a really high degree of reliability. So voltage signals are used, for example, in air conditioning systems. If you are measuring temperature in a room, if you control that, then it doesn't really matter if you control that within 0.5 or 1 centigrade. It's not that important. But in industrial systems, we need higher reliability, and we also need protection from electromagnetic interference. Voltage signals are very sensitive to noise, to electromagnetic interference. Electromagnetic interference is all around us, and if you measure that, you will see that induced voltage from the power network is everywhere. Here you have two examples. This was a reading in one application where the temperature was measured with thermocouples. So the same sensor like I am using here, the voltage is very small. So it's very sensitive to noise. And this straight line is the measured temperature when everything was off except the thermocouple. It was a boiler heated by some furnace. And you see it's quite nice straight line. There's no visible interference. And this image on the right side is the same reading, the same signal, when the pump for the water circuit was turned on. So here you see there's still the same signal, the temperature was exactly the same, but instead of this nice straight line, you have this. So then what is the temperature that you measure? This is jumping up and down, you need to make some average, but in any case it's very sensitive to noise. So voltage signals are good in applications where you do not have pumps, but you don't have motors, but you don't have frequency inverters. So typical application is air conditioning. You have somewhere the temperature sensor, and really far away from this you have the fan that is blowing the air. You have some heater somewhere very far away. In industrial systems, you can have the sensors, and then you can have the motors very close. So in industrial systems, we are definitely using current output. So the vast majority of industrial sensors have some form of current output. Current output is much less sensitive to noise, or simply because the resistance in the current loop is very small, typically below 600 ohms, and therefore it would take a really large energy to change the current in the circuit. So current output is much less sensitive than voltage signal. If we use the 4 to 20 milliamperes range, then we can quite easily detect what is the condition of the loop. If there is some problem in the loop, if there is some loose wires or some open circuit. Simply because the minimal current that can be in the loop is 4 milliamperes. And if the current is zero, then I know that there is some open circuit. However, the length of the current loop is limited by the maximum resistance in the loop. Here we can have a schematic. So this is my sensor. This is the wire resistance. And this is the receiver, the control system. As I measure current, the current in the loop is the same everywhere. So I don't have the problem as I had in voltage circuit that I had something on the output of the sensor and I measured something different on the receiver. The current has to be the same in all the loop. So this problem is eliminated. However, if I keep increasing the wire resistance, if I want to keep the current in the loop, I need to increase the output voltage. That's Ohm's law. So the voltage on the sensor output has some limits, let's say for safety reasons 50 volts, and therefore I'm limited in the value of the wire resistance. A typical receiver input resistance is 100 ohms, so this gives me about 500 ohms for the wire resistance. So if you look to some standards and to some sensor specifications, you will find out that typically the wire resistance or loop resistance is limited to a value below 600 ohms. So if I'm below this value, then the current output is working as it should. If for some reason I would connect a wire with a higher resistance, then I will have a problem. Let's say I will have a steady state characteristic. So this is an example of a steady state characteristic, let's say some sensor with input X, and this will be the output I, the current. So if everything is fine, then let's say it looks like this. It's a linear response from 0 to 1. So from minimal value to maximum value. It doesn't really matter what kind of sensor this is. If I connect a wire with a higher resistance, then the typical effect is something like this. So the steady state response is linear here, and then you have a constant value. So the result is that I will limit the range in which this sensor can operate, because here I have sensitivity zero. I'm changing the input, but the output is not changing. And I have limited the range where the sensor can operate. And you can see this only on the shape of the steady state characteristic, but you can't see that just by reading the values from the sensor output. Because here you will say, okay, I have this value, this value, and this value, but without looking really what are the correct values on the input, you can't tell that your sensor operates correctly. So that's why it's quite important to keep this resistance in a loop below the 600 ohms. We have one lab specifically related to that, where you will measure exactly this type of chart and where you will play with the resistance in the loop, and you will see what happens with the current and voltage in the circuit. Questions? Okay, so now we will start with temperature sensors, and we will start with placement of temperature sensors. So this will be a common thing for all contact temperature sensors. So all the sensors that you will see next week will have to be placed like this. So, sensors in industrial systems, or temperature sensors, needs some protection. So sensors are placed in thermal wells. Thermal well is a device that protects the sensor from mechanical and chemical damage. And the sensor is inside this thermal well. And then the whole thermal well is placed in the process. It can be a pipe, it can be a tank, for example. I have here some examples of thermal wells that I will show you. So, those are thermal wells. Thermal wells can be made from metal. This is typically for, let's say, relatively lower temperatures, let's say 600, 800 centigrades. If you want higher temperatures, then you can have ceramic thermal wells. And the sensor itself then looks like this. This is a thermocouple. It's then placed into a pipe like this. This is a double sensor. But let's say like this, it's a single sensor. So the sensor is somewhere here. It has terminals over there, and this is then installed in the thermal well. You can take a look yourselves on that. You can also remove the cover over here, and you will see that there is something inside. This is a thermocouple as well. So let me just remove that. So here you see that's the sensor inside with the terminals. This is a thermal well with a thread, and then this is installed in a pipe or in some tank where you want to measure temperature. So this thermal well assures chemical and mechanical protection of the sensor. The metallic thermal wells are used typically for lower temperatures, let's say 600 or 800 centigrades, something in this range. The ceramic thermal wells are used for higher temperatures. So the temperature range depends on the thermal well, and it also depends on the sensor itself. Not all sensors can operate in the whole temperature range. We need to select the sensor that is appropriate for our application. In any case, the rules that we need to maintain when we install any temperature sensor are that we want to maximize the heat transfer from the medium, from the environment, to the sensor. So from the water in the tank or in the pipe into the thermal well to the sensor. But at the same time, I need to prevent some losses inside the thermal well. So I need to minimize the heat transfer between the thermal well and between the ambient environment. So if you remember those two rules, then you will be able to install the sensors properly. And this is valid not only for tanks or pipes, but in general for all applications with temperature sensors. So let's start with sensor placement in pipes. I want to maximize the heat transfer from the pipe into the thermal well. So it means I need to maximize the surface area of the thermal well. So if I have a thermal well and a pipe with a large diameter, so for example like this, this is a large pipe diameter, then the thermal well can go directly inside of the pipe with an angle of 90 degrees. So the axis of the pipe is going like this, and here the thermal well is going straight in. If for some reason I have a small pipe diameter, then I can do this. I can change the angle between the pipe and the thermal well, and I can put it like that, so I will increase the area that is inside of the pipe, and by increasing the area, I will increase the heat transfer. So this is the typical angle, 45 degrees, and in this case, you need to orient that against the flow direction. If it is installed like that, then it doesn't matter if the flow direction is up or down. But here, if you orient the thermal well in this direction, then you must have the flow direction from the left to the right. So in this case, you cannot have a pipe where eventually the flow direction goes in both ways. So how far do you need to insert the thermal well into the pipe? So typically, the insertion depth is about 0.5 of the pipe diameter. So if this is the pipe diameter, then the thermal well is going all the way to the middle of the pipe, so to the axis. So the thermal well is this, and the sensor is at the end of the thermal well over here. So this is the temperature sensor, and it's protected by the thermal well, and then it's inside a pipe. So this will maximize me the heat transfer from the pipe, from the medium in the pipe, into the thermal well. And here you also see that we have some insulation layer. So this will minimize me the heat losses. So the heat transfer from the pipe, I can also have insulation around this thermal well over here. And this will minimize me the heat transfer from the thermal well to ambient air. The insertion depth depends, however, also on the speed of your liquid or fluid. So if you have some slow fluid in the pipe, it can be all the way to the middle of the pipe. But if you have some fast flowing liquid, then this may happen. This is a flow direction from the left to the right. This is the thermal well. And if you have a fast flow, then you can have something that's called a von Karman vortex. So this will make vibrations on the thermal well. And if your thermal well is too long, then it can fail in time. So in this case, you can make the thermal well shorter to prevent the vibrations. This will obviously have a worst heat transfer, but since the flow rate is high, then it will still be enough to transfer the heat into the thermal well. So if you have something like really fast flowing air or liquids, then it's better idea to have a shorter thermal well just below the 50% of the pipe diameter, and this will increase the life of the thermal well. One advantage of the thermal well is also that if you have a thermal well installed in your application, so something like this, a thermal well installed somewhere, then this allows you to exchange the sensor without interrupting the process. So you just remove the sensor from the thermal well. This is sealed, so nothing leaks. You don't need to stop your production, and you just put a new sensor in the thermal well. So it also simplifies maintenance. But what are the disadvantages of a thermal well? What do you think? So the disadvantage of the thermal well is that it will change the dynamic behavior of the sensor. The sensor is inside a thermal well. So if I change something, if I change the temperature of the fluid, then it will take some time before the heat is transferred from the fluid through the thermal well into the sensor. So if I make the thermal well larger, it will increase the time constant. So the sensor will not be able to pick up fast changes of the temperature. On the other hand, if I make the thermal well thicker, it will provide better mechanical and chemical protection. So that's a trade-off. Either you want a fast sensor, so you install that in a small thermal well, but it will not be a good protection. Or you make the thermal well really thick, but then you will not be able to pick up fast changes of the temperature. So a thermal well is changing definitely the dynamic behavior. How about static behavior? Is the thermal well changing the steady state characteristic of the sensor? It's not, because a steady state characteristic is a dependence of sensor output on sensor input in steady state. So when I have a constant output and constant input, and it means I need to wait until I have reached steady state. But then it will be exactly the same. So, for example, if this would be the steady state characteristic of a temperature sensor, then it would be exactly the same regardless of the type of the thermal well where it's installed. The only thing that will change is the dynamic behavior. So, to give you an idea about the dynamic behavior of the sensor, let's say, I'll take this sensor. This is a thermocouple. So this thermal well could have a time constant of, let's say, probably around 60 seconds. So I need to wait at least 5 minutes before I can read the sensor output. The thermal well made from ceramics that you have seen, it's at the end here, can have a time constant of roughly, let's say, 5 minutes. So it is protecting in a better way the sensor, but then it's increasing the time constant. And in the lab classes, we will also play a little bit with that, and we will compare the time constant of the same sensor that is installed in a different thermal well. So, how do you install the temperature sensor in a pipe? Well, either you have enough space and then you do this, or you don't have enough space and you can do this. So if you have a tube with a small diameter and you need to install the temperature sensor, you can install that in or like that, like this, and then the temperature sensor is installed in this third connection inside the thermowell, and you see it's going all the way to the middle of the flow so that it can have a good heat transfer. You obviously will also need some insulation to prevent heat losses. You can do also this, so a T configuration. So here you see a straight pipe, and then in this T piece you have this thermowell. This is the sensor, this is the thermowell, and you see it's going all the way to the middle of the pipe. It would depend on the flow rate, but let's say 50% of the pipe diameter is the typical length. So now, what happens if you do not keep this in mind? In other words, what happens if you do not install your sensors correctly? If you install that in a different position. So here is a comparison of the errors based on the positioning of the temperature sensor. The application was to measure the steam temperature, which the correct temperature was 386 centigrades, pressure 2 bars, and here you see 5 different positions where the sensors are installed. The sensors are the same, they differ only in position and they differ in the type of thermowell. So let's say that position B is the best position. Why is it the best? Because here it's going against the flow direction. Here at this band, at this area, you have turbulent flow, and turbulent flow provides you maximum heat transfer. So at this point, I can be sure that I measure the correct temperature. Plus, here you see I have insulation, so the heat losses from the thermowell into the ambient environment are minimized. So the best position in this kind of application is this position, against flow direction in the area where you have maximum turbulence. The same thermowell, just installed in this position, will give you a really large error in temperature reading. Here, if the flow is going in this way, in this area like this, you have an area with very small turbulence. Here you have low heat transfer from the fluid into the thermowell. Plus, thermowell A is not insulated, so in this application it was measured that the temperature error is 45 centigrades less. So here I have 386 centigrades and I have error of 45, so that's much bigger than 10%. So just by placing the sensor incorrectly, you can completely ruin the accuracy of your measurement. This sensor can measure with a high accuracy. We will see sensors that have accuracy of something better than 1%, so something like 3 centigrades in this case, or 4. But just by placing it incorrectly, you will ruin the accuracy. So position A is the worst position that you can use. Position C here, you see it's not that bad. It's insulated, so I minimize the heat transfer losses. It's not far from this optimal position, so it will still be okay. It's going to roughly 1/2 of the pipe diameter. But it has a different shape because this is a thin wall thermowell. A thin wall thermowell will give you a shorter time constant, but will provide less protection from mechanical and chemical damage. So position C is not that bad. It was measured that the error is only 1 centigrade, and it will be definitely faster than thermowell B because it has thinner walls and the heat transfer will happen faster. Position D is a little bit farther away from the ideal position, so you will have a higher error. Position D in this case is a thick wall thermowell, so it will have a very good mechanical and chemical protection, but very long time constant. So if I compare B, C and D, then C is the fastest, B is somewhere between, and D is the slowest one. The sensor can be exactly the same. It can have exactly the same time constant, but just placing it in a different thermowell, I will change the time constant of the whole set. And position E is much farther away from the optimal position. It is shorter, so it does not have such a good heat transfer. You see, it's shorter than D or C, so you can expect that in this position you will have a higher error, and in this case it was measured that it's about 15 centigrades. So it's not only a question of selecting the correct sensor, but it's also very important to know how to place it. We'll make an experiment in the labs related to that. Okay. Thanks. So, if you want to measure the correct temperature in a tank, then you need to provide some stirring. Because if you do not mix the liquid, then something like this will happen. You will have cold water on the bottom, hot water on top, and now what temperature do you want to measure? Do you want to measure it here, or here, or here, or in some other position? So if you want some uniform temperature in a tank, you need to mix the liquids. So it typically looks like this in a lab. So this is a tank with water that is heated, and the noise that you hear is the mixing, and this will provide us a constant temperature in the whole tank. The installation is the same, so the sensor is protected by a thermowell, and the material of the thermowell depends on the liquid that you have in the tank. So it can be metal, can be ceramics, can be any other material that is good for your application. Okay, and if you have some solid bodies, then here you still need to maximize the heat transfer from the object to the sensor, and to minimize the heat transfer from the sensor into the ambient air. So on the left side here, you see how to install that if you have a good heat conductor. And on the left side, you have an example of a bad heat conductor. The difference is that if you have a good heat conductor, then if I connect a temperature sensor directly to the surface, since this is a good heat conductor, then I will not disturb that much the temperature field by placing the sensor. So for a good heat conductor, I can typically place the sensor directly on the surface, either just hold it against the surface or weld it to the surface or solder it. If I have a bad heat conductor, if I install the sensor, I will disturb quite much the temperature field on this object, so I need to embed the sensor typically inside the object, make a hole, make a slot, something like that, and cover that with the insulation. You can do it also for the metallic objects for good heat conductors, but here the effects will not be so significant as, for example, ceramic materials that are not good heat conductors. Questions? No questions. Great. So, we have like 13 minutes remaining, so we'll start shortly with the first temperature sensor, and it will be a thermocouple. So, a thermocouple is one of the very common sensors used in industrial systems because it's very cheap. You can produce it yourself, and you can have many thermocouples in your application, and you like hundreds of thermocouples, and it's not that expensive like the other sensors that we will cover next week. One very important thing for a thermocouple, however, is that a thermocouple does not measure temperature. It measures temperature difference. On one side of the thermocouple, we have so-called hot end or hot junction. That is where we measure something. And on the other side, we have something that we call a cold junction or a reference junction. And the output signal is proportional not to temperature T1, so not to the temperature of the hot junction, but it's proportional to the temperature difference between hot junction and cold junction. So the output that you measure on the output with a voltmeter is dependent on the temperature difference. So regardless of the temperature T1, if you keep the constant temperature difference, you will get the constant voltage. So, for example, if this would be 300 centigrades and this would be 50 centigrades, then it would show you 250. But it will show you the same voltage if you have here, let's say 600 centigrades, and here if you have 350 centigrades. So the voltage will be the same. So for thermocouple, the output signal is voltage, but it remember that it's proportional to the temperature difference. Typically, this is in your application. It's then going to some terminal box, and you have some connecting wires between this terminal box and between your measuring instrument. So this could be your controller system. The material of the wiring depends on the type of the thermocouple. So for some types of thermocouple, it is the same material like you have here on the thermocouple. For more expensive materials like platinum, this would be really expensive, so then we use other types of wires that have similar properties in a smaller temperature ranges. The thermocouple here is made from two materials, two dissimilar metals typically. It works also with semiconductors, but all the thermocouples that I will cover here in this course will be made from metals. So for example, one wire here will be iron, and the other wire will be some other alloy. And thermocouples at the hot junction are produced by welding. So the last thing that we will do today is that we will weld a thermocouple here. I have here a thermocouple wire. This is the welder. So this is a thermocouple wire. So this is this thing over here. And we will train the procedure on the lab, but now I'll just show you what happens. We will weld the thermocouple. Are you afraid of sparks? No? That's good. So you will do this yourself on the labs. So I have already prepared everything here. So those are the two thermocouple wires. And here I have one electrode and a second electrode, and we'll weld that together. It's essentially a bank of capacitors. So what it is doing is that it will discharge a specific charge into the weld, and it will produce the thermocouple. So let's do it. Need to charge it. I need to wait before it's charged. Okay, now it's ready. So there will be a spark. So don't be afraid. And it's ready. So don't look into the weld. Okay. Said you're afraid of the sparks. And here, well, I had a too large charge, and here you should see a ball of the welded metal. But in this case, it didn't happen, but it still would work like a thermocouple. Okay? So, that's all for today. We'll finish thermocouples next week. And now we have 5 remaining minutes for the Moodle test. So if you want some bonus tests, some bonus point, then you can log in to the Moodle. From now on, it will happen on every lecture at a random time, typically when we finish some topic. The Moodle test for today, you can find it here in bonus tests, and here it's called bonus test 1 basics done on the second lecture. So if you have some device with internet access, then go to this course, and today it will be called basics 1, and right now you should be able to enter the quiz, and when you are registered, then I will start the quiz, and the answers, the questions will appear. So I give you some moment to get in. So you will find it in this section, instrumentation and control engineering, then measurement in engineering. You need to be registered for the course, and then it's the tab called test bonus test. Ready? Okay. So who's not ready? 3, okay. So there will be 4 questions. 2 are related to the previous lecture, 2 are related to today's lecture. It's typically ABCD answers. there is one numerical answer as well, and you have, it's very easy questions. You have 45 seconds for the answer. You have 1 attempt, so if you submit the answer, you can't change it anymore. If you leave it checked and do not submit that after those 45 seconds, it will automatically submit me the answer. Okay, ready? Good. So let's start the quiz. I will shortly disable the screen. So there will be a question appearing in a few seconds. Okay, so this was related to last week. What is the best way to use an analog instrument? So it is to be in the last third of the scale, preferably work with the maximum deflection. For all of you, it automatically changes here the ABCDs, so you may have a different answer than your neighbor. And just to show you what I see here is how many people have answered correctly. So there's this part, and those people did not answer correctly. So it's for me also a feedback, how well did you understand the topic. Okay, I'm sending question two. Okay, so it was easy. Steady state is reached when both input and output are steady. Question three. So this is a calculation, so enter a number. Some connection, I don't know. Looks like it hit safe. I don't know what happens. It sometimes happens when it loses the connection. So this was calculation.
Question disappeared? Yeah.
Uh-huh. Someone answered. I don't know. It's maybe we lost some connection. Anyway, the correct answer is three times the number that was the input. Okay, and let's see if we will see the fourth question. So this has multiple correct possible answers. So check all what you think is correct. If you check everything, then the sum is zero. In other words, you can't check everything. everything is not correct. Again, it lost. Strange. But I see some answers here. From like 14 people have answered. Yeah. So, correct answers here, unified voltage signals 0 to 10 volts and 0 to 5 volts. Okay. That's it. I'm closing the session, and now we should be able to see your points when you log in to the Moodle. That's it, and see you next week. Yes? Not working? I don't know. What's the problem? And anyway, it's just 1% of the total points from the semester. You can get the points on the classes as well. So, see you next week.